Good afternoon, students. Today we will start with the next topic of our circulation chapter. Today's topic is blood pressure. Blood pressure is basically the pressure which is exerted by the flowing blood on the walls of the blood vessels. This pressure is high in the arteries and it gradually drops in the arterioles. Arterioles are basically the fine branches of the arteries that arises from the arteries. And from the arteries arises still finer branches, which are the capillaries. The capillaries then join to form the venules, and the venules join to form the veins. So this blood pressure or the arterial pressure is high in the arteries. It gradually drops in the arterioles and capillaries, and it is very low in case of the veins. So what happens is that this is the basic explanation of the pressure, the high pressure and the low pressure. From left atrium, the blood enters into the left ventricle, and from here it enters into the aorta. The large systemic aorta. The pressure which is exerted by the blood on the aorta is referred to as the arterial blood pressure, and it is a very high pressure. Then it goes to the tissues, and from tissues the deoxygenated blood returns from the through great veins, superior vena cava and inferior vena cava, into the right atrium, and from right atrium the blood enters into the left ventricle. Here the flow of the blood is very low and the pressure of the blood is very low. This blood pressure is referred to as the venous blood pressure, as the blood is flowing in the veins. This pressure, the arterial blood pressure, ranges from 120 to 80 mmHg, whereas the venous blood pressure is a 0 mmHg. Apart from these two pressure, there is also a peripheral resistance, which is the blood vessels also provides the resistance to the blood flow inside them. That is referred to as the peripheral resistance. So the total cardiac output is the arterial blood pressure minus the venous blood pressure divided by the peripheral resistance. As venous blood pressure is 0 mmHg, therefore cardiac output is equal to the blood pressure or arterial blood pressure and the peripheral resistance. This peripheral resistance is altered by vasoconstriction and vasodilatation. If there is vasoconstriction, the blood vessels constrict, then the blood pressure increases because of the increase on the pressure of the pressure on the flow of the blood, and during vasodilation there is fall in the BP. Control of the blood pressure is under the control of the vasomotor center, which is present in the medulla oblongata of the brain. The arteriolar blood pressure, or simply the BP or blood pressure, it rises with the contraction of the heart, which is referred to as the systolic pressure, which is 120, and it falls during the relaxation of the heart, which is diastolic pressure. This blood pressure is measured in the terms of millimeters of mercury, which is referred to as mmHg, millimeter of mercury, and it is measured by the instrument which is called as sphygmomanometer. How this blood pressure is measured, a video will be sent to you for this demonstration of the measurement of the blood pressure along with this e-lecture. Then comes the blood. Blood is basically the fluid connective tissue. It flows in case of the mammals or the higher organism, it flows inside the blood vessels. We have closed circulatory system because our blood flows inside the closed vessels, which are arteries and veins. The fluid which is present outside the cells is referred to as the extracellular fluid. These are the intravascular fluid in blood vessels and plasma. And the average adult human has about 6.8 to 7 liters of the blood, out of which there is the total blood which is present, 6 to 10% by body weight, and 30 to 35% forms the extracellular fluid. The blood is basically composed of the plasma, which forms the 55% of the total blood, and 45% is formed by the formed elements. The plasma is pale yellow, it is slightly alkaline, it consists of 90% of the water, 1% inorganic salts which are present in the form of crystalloids, and 7 or 8% of the proteins which are present in the form of colloids. Formed elements is formed of RBCs, WBCs and platelets. In general, the vascular tissue consists of the two parts, the blood and the lymph. The blood is formed of plasma and the formed elements. Lymph is formed of the plasma and the leukocytes. It does not have any RBCs or the platelets. This plasma is formed of the water crystalloids, which are the inorganic salts, and the colloids, which are the proteins. Formed elements consist of the corpuscles and the platelets. Corpuscles are WBCs or leukocytes, RBCs or erythrocytes, and thrombocytes. WBCs are further of two types, the granulocytes, in which their cytoplasm has the granules. It is further of three kinds, the basophil, eosinophils and neutrophils, and agranulocytes, which are monocytes and the lymphocytes. The detailed description will, the detail of these different kind of cells will be described later in this lecture. The capillary wall is permeable to the solution of the crystalloids. It is permeable to the solution of the crystalloids, which diffuse out of the plasma and forms the tissue fluid. But the colloids are not able to pass through it. Plasma volume decreases if the fluid intake is low, and if there is followed by excessive perspiration and diarrhea, it results into dehydration. So first we will start with the plasma. Plasma consists of the proteins. It has inorganic salts, it has water, it has waste material, dissolved gases, so on. So first the proteins. The proteins which are present in the plasma are serum albumin, serum globulin, serum porphyrin, serum prothrombin and serum fibrinogen. First the serum albumin. It is the most abundant protein and it coagulates on heating. Globulins also coagulate on heating. It is further of three types, the alpha globulins, beta globulins and gamma globulins. Alpha and beta globulins are get associated with the carbohydrates and the lipids and results in the formation of glycoproteins and lipoproteins, whereas the gamma globulins forms the antibodies. Propyrin is gamma 2 globulin. Prothrombin is also a globulin. It is stored and formed in the parenchymal cells of the liver. The thromboblastin and calcium converts this prothrombin to thrombin, which then converts the fibrinogen to fibrin, which helps in the blood clotting. And there is fibrinogen protein, which is also a globulin. And this fibrinogen gets converted into fibrin by the thrombin, which gets converted into thrombin with the help of thromboblastin and calcium ions. The functions of plasma. Plasma acts as raw material for the proteins of the tissues. It also acts as buffer because it is a source of amino acid. It helps in the transport of certain materials, such as alpha globulin helps in the transport of thyroxine and vitamin B12. Similarly, beta globulin helps in the transfer of insulin, vitamin A, D, K and lipids. Gamma globulin helps in the transport of antigens and histamine. Albumin helps in the transport of calcium, bilirubin and tryptophan. Gamma globulins also act as antibodies or immunoglobulins. Propyrin destroys the bacteria, neutralizes certain viruses and damage foreign RBCs. And this plasma also helps in blood clotting. Inorganic salts which are present in the plasma are sodium and calcium ions, which are the principal cation and anion. Apart from this, there are bicarbonates and phosphates, which are the anions. Potassium, magnesium, iron, manganese, half of the calcium is present. And the inorganic as the crystalloid form. Food materials which are present in the plasma are glucose, amino acid, fatty acids and triglycerides. Waste products which are present are urea, uric acid, ammonia and creatinine. The dissolved gases which are present are, there are certain dissolved gases, dissolved small amount of dissolved oxygen, carbon dioxide. There are anticoagulants and there is cholesterol. Then comes the RBCs. This was all about the plasma part of the blood. Now comes the RBCs. RBCs are basically red because it carries the oxygen carrying pigment hemoglobin, which imparts the red color to this. It is confined to the blood. It also has an enzyme which is carbonic anhydrase, which is very important in the transport of carbon dioxide. In case of fishes, amphibian, reptiles and birds, the RBCs are oval. RBCs are also referred to as erythrocytes. They are oval, biconvex and nucleated. But in case of mammals, they are circular, biconcave and denucleated disc. This shapes provides the flexibility and also provides the larger surface area to volume ratio. There are certain exceptions, but in case of mammals, for example, in camel and llama, instead of being biconvex and circular, it is oval RBCs. In men, the total number of RBCs, average number, is 5 million per millimeter cube of the blood. In case of women, it is 4.5 million per millimeter cube of the blood. The decrease in the number of RBCs results in anemia. Abnormal increase in RBCs number is referred to as polycythemia, and the decrease in number of RBCs is referred to as erythrocytopenia. And decrease in number of RBCs results in the shortage of oxygen. When seen singly, the RBCs are yellowish in color, whereas it appears red when present in bulk. RBCs are surrounded by elastic semi-permeable membrane. It is devoid of any kind of nucleus, endoplasmic reticulum, mitochondria, ribosomes and centrioles. And this Absence of these organelles is very advantageous as it creates more of the space for the hemoglobin, more of the hemoglobin to be concentrated in the RBCs. And it also inhibits the utilization of the oxygen, which is to be carried by the RBCs to the different parts of the body, to be consumed inside the RBCs because of the less amount of the energy which is required by the RBCs. The formation of RBCs is referred to as erythropoiesis. It occurs in the liver and mesenchyme in the early fetus. In late fetus, it occurs in spleen and bone marrow. In children, it occurs in the red bone marrow of the long bones. In case of adults, it occurs in the red bone marrow of the skull, ribs, sternum, and vertebrae. So whenever there is oxygen deficiency, it stimulates the kidney cells to secrete a hormone which is referred to as the erythropoietin in the blood. This erythropoietin then stimulates the bone marrow. This is the bone and this is the bone marrow internal of the bone. This erythropoietin stimulates the formation of the RBCs in the bone marrow. As a result, increased number of RBCs are put into the circulation. It increases the delivery of oxygen to tissues. The oxygen deficiency can be because of the hemorrhage or when a person goes to the high altitude, there is decrease in the number of RBCs in the circulation. There is decreased, as there is decrease in the number of RBCs, there will be decreased delivery of the oxygen to the tissues. This will stimulate the kidneys to produce the erythropoietin and it will increase the production of the RBCs in the bone marrow and hence there will be increase in the number of RBCs in the circulation. The RBCs gets energy from the anaerobic glycolysis and hexose monophosphate shunt. The lifespan of the RBCs is 120 days. The worn out RBCs undergo phagocytosis in spleen and liver. Spleen is also referred to as the blood bank and the graveyard of the RBCs. The RBCs, when they undergo phagocytosis, their proteins is converted into the amino acids and their hemoglobin. Hemoglobin's iron part is stored and extracted and stored in the liver in the form of ferritin, while rest of the hemoglobin is converted into the bile pigments, which are then released through the bile juices. The RBCs, when they are in the resting phase, they come closer to each other and result in the formation of the piled structure. This is referred to as the Rolex formation. They also have the property of the hemolysis agglutination. Then comes the WBCs. WBCs change their shape. They show amoeboid movements. They can move from the capillaries into the tissue fluid with the help of a mechanism which is known as the diapedesis. Their number ranges from 5,000 to 10,000 per millimeter cube of the blood. The increase in WBC is referred to as the leukocytosis. Decrease in WBC is referred to as leukopenia. Leukocytosis can occur during infection or inflammatory response when the number of WBCs has to be increased by the body so as to defend the body against such infections or inflammations. Decrease in the number of WBCs, that is leukopenia, occurs in AIDS virus. WBCs are also referred to as the white blood corpuscles, white blood cells, or leukocytes. Leukopoiesis basically occurs in the hemopoietic organ, which are lymph nodes, spleen, thymus, and red bone marrow. WBCs are broadly categorized into two categories, the agranulocytes and granulocytes. Agranulocytes have non-lobed nucleus and their cytoplasm is clear. It does not have any kind of the granules. They are of two types, the monocytes and the lymphocytes. Monocytes are formed in the bone marrow. They are the largest of all the leukocytes. They form 2 to 6% of the total leukocyte which is present in the body. They are phagocytic in function and when present in the tissue, they get converted into the macrophages to perform the phagocytosis. These are the monocytes. They have kidney or bean-shaped nucleus. They are the largest of all the leukocytes. These are the two agranulocytes and they are the granulocyte. Then comes lymphocytes. Lymphocytes are of two kinds, the B lymphocytes and the T lymphocytes. They are formed in the thymus and the lymphoid tissue. Their number is 25% of the total leukocytes which are present in the blood. They are non-motile, they are non-phagocytic. They secrete antibodies or cytolysin to break the bacterial cell wall. And they are the main cells which are involved in the humoral or antibody-mediated immune response and the cell-mediated immune response. These are the lymphocytes. They have a large nucleus which covers the entire cytoplasm. Then comes the granulocytes. Granulocytes have the granules in their cytoplasm. Their nucleus are lobed. They are also formed in the bone marrow from myeloblast cells. They are of three kinds: neutrophils, eosinophils, and basophils. First of all, the basophils. The basophils forms 0.5% of the total leukocytes which are present in the blood. They are the circulating mast cells. They are granules. They have irregular S-shaped nucleus. Their granules consist of histamine. They release anticoagulant and histamine in the blood. Then comes eosinophils. Eosinophils are also called as acidophils. They die very well with the acidic dye. Basophils dies with the basic dyes. They have antihistamine in their granules. They have bilobed nucleus. They destroy the toxins produced in antigen-antibody interactions. And their granules have the clot dissolving factor. Then comes the neutrophils. It is 3 to 5 lobed. It is the leukocyte which is present in the largest number. It concentration ranges from 50 to 70% of the total leukocytes which are present in the cell. They are also referred to as polymorphonuclear leukocytes or polymorphs. They are phagocytic in function. Their granules have the lysosomes which helps in the digestion of or disposing off of various foreign substances, bacteria, viruses. The dead neutrophils forms the pus, and this pus consists of the dead bacteria and the cell debris. One side of the nucleus of the neutrophils also consists of the sex chromatin in case of female, which is referred to as drumstick. So this is also analyzed so as to detect the sex or the gender of the organism. Then comes the platelets. These are the platelets. They are non-nucleated. They lack hemoglobin. They are present only in mammals. They are disc-like. Their number ranges from 2,50,000 to 5 lakh per millimeter cube. The increase in the number of platelets is referred to as thrombocytosis, and their decrease is referred to as thrombocytopenia. They are colorless as the leukocyte. They are non-nucleated fragments of giant cells which are called as megakaryocytes of the bone marrow. In the center, there are basophilic granules. There is concentration or the group of the basophilic granules. These are not the nucleus. They are the granules, groups of the granules of basophilic granules. They have the enzyme which is referred to as thromboplastin, which helps in clotting, blood clotting. Their lifespan is 3 to 7 days. They are disposed of in liver and spleen. Then is the thrombocytes. Thrombocytes are the spindle cells which are present in vertebrates. They have a nucleus, round central nucleus. No nucleolus is present. They are formed in the bone marrow and they help in the clotting of the blood. So the formed elements, corpuscles, platelets, RBCs, WBCs, thrombocytes, agranulocyte, granulocyte, and platelets have been discussed of the blood. This was the complete composition of the blood. Now the hemopoiesis. Hemopoiesis is the phenomena of the formation of the corpuscles, and the region where the hemopoiesis takes place are referred to as the hemopoietic organ or tissue. So this is the erythropoiesis, this is leukopoiesis, and this is the formation of the platelets. First, the erythropoiesis. Basically, the hemopoiesis occurs in the red bone marrow by special kind of cells which are referred to as hemocytoblast. This hemocytoblast has a large nucleus, darkly stained nucleus. It divides to form special cells which are referred to as proerythroblast. This proerythroblast then divides and results in the formation of the erythrocyte in other organisms. But in case of vertebrates, the formation of erythrocytes, mammals basically, it is a complicated process. What happens is that this proerythroblast, which is formed by the division of hemocytoblast, again divides, and there is shrinkage of the cells, there is shrinkage of the nucleus, and results in the formation of early normoblast. And also during the formation of erythrocyte from the proerythroblast, there is accumulation of the hemoglobin in the cytoplasm. This early normoblast still undergo further shrinkage of the nucleus and development of the hemoglobin pigment. It gets converted into the late normoblast, which later form the reticulocytes, which are the early stages of the erythrocyte. The young immature stages of the erythrocytes are referred to as the reticulocyte, which still have the fragments of the nucleus. Then the nucleus completely degenerates and results in the formation of the erythrocyte. This is erythropoiesis. Then comes the leukopoiesis. Leukopoiesis also occurs by the cells hemocytoblast. Hemocytoblast has three different kinds of cells, which results in the formation of the different kinds of the leukocytes. First are the myeloblasts. These myeloblasts have large nucleus. It divides to form three types of different cells, which are the neutrophil myelocyte, eosinophil myelocyte, and the basophil myelocyte. These give rise to their respective leukocyte. The neutrophil myelocyte results in the formation of the neutrophils. Eosinophil myelocyte results in the formation of eosinophil. Basophil myelocyte results in the formation of the basophil. Then comes the monoblast. This monoblast results in the formation of the monocyte. And the lymphoblast, it results in the formation of the large lymphocytes, which later results in the formation of small lymphocytes. The platelets are formed by the large giant cells, which are multinucleated cells, which are referred to as megakaryocytes. These megakaryocytes extend into the blood cyanoids with the help of the pseudopodia, and these pseudopodia pinch off in the non-nucleated fragment, which are referred to as the platelets. So this was all about the hemopoiesis.